Hi, I'm Kaylee Whalen, an autistic, transgender, Puerto Rican, and Guatemalan American. And I'm here in Huehuetenango, Guatemala, to talk about autism in Latin American cultures. So stay tuned. So one note on language for this video is that I'm talking about Latin American cultures primarily in the United States. And there's some debate around what term to use for people with Latin American heritage. So one of the older terms that I grew up with and many people still use is Hispanic, which is based on the language of Spanish and the origins of Spain as a country, which was a colonizer of much of Latin America. Now, both because I'm not talking about Spanish-speaking populations, I'm specifically talking about populations from Latin America and in Latin America, the more appropriate term, which would also include Portuguese speakers, would be Latino. Now, I also want to be inclusive of gender-neutral and gender non-binary people and gender-neutral pronouns and language. So in 2014, the term Latinx became popular. However, more recently, especially native Spanish speakers and people in Latin American countries have started adopting Latine as a gender-neutral term. So in a few weeks ago, I actually recorded a video where I talked about my Latinx heritage. And since then, one organization that I very much support and do some work for, the Autistic Women Non-Binary Network, we decided to switch to the use of Latine, as it is easier to conjugate and matches better with traditional Spanish spoken language. So I'm gonna be talking about people of Latin American descent, and I'll be primarily using Latine in this, although I may refer to myself as Latina, as I do identify with a feminine gender identity and pronouns. Hello, so location change. I had to re-record part of this video, but fact one about autism in Latin American communities is that autism has always existed in Latin American countries and in Latine populations in the United States. It's just been underdiagnosed, misunderstood, and I would say the science and medical literature has not really permeated much of Spanish-speaking or Portuguese-speaking Latin America in the way that it has English-speaking populations in the United States. So when we talk about autism, we often think about how in the United States there's been a ton of visibility since the 1990s. There was a surge in autistic self-advocacy in the early to mid-2000s in the United States. And I don't think that surge has yet really reached many Spanish-speaking Latine communities in the US. And that is part of what I'll be discussing here about the need for more resources, information, and advocacy for Latine, especially non-English speaking Latine folks in the US, and the need for kind of more international Latin American education, advocacy around autism. So one thing I've talked about in previous videos, and I'll touch on more in this video, is that not only am I Latine or a Latina autistic person, my grandfather, Federico Serres, who I featured in a video where I talked about my Guatemalan and Puerto Rican heritage. Fred, my grandfather, was almost certainly autistic, but every textbook kind of definition of it and all the facts that I've been able to glean from interviewing his friends, interviewing his doctor, interviewing his family, he certainly has almost all the markers of autistic behavior. And considering my whole life I've been compared to my grandfather, it is
obvious to me, even if it's not obvious to others, that he has or had autism. Also because most of the autism diagnosis criteria were developed in the 1940s and then, unfortunately, Bruno Bettelheim in the 1950s popularized some really awful ideas about autism. This was long after my grandfather would have been diagnosed or picked up, and we still have very low rates of diagnosis in Latin American communities, in adults, especially older adults. So definitely was someone who was missed. But to me, as someone born around 1920, he's proof that autism has always existed, and it's just been understood in different ways. So, fact number two is autism is underdiagnosed and diagnosed later in life for Latine children and adults. Now, one of the main studies that I'm going to cite is in Academic Pediatrics, and it interviewed 33 families, primarily Mexican-American, about experiences around autism. And in this study, with interviews with parents, it identified many of the reasons that parents have difficulty getting diagnoses for their children and certain cultural barriers, which I'll touch on next, for why they might not seek out or understand an autism diagnosis. Autism is diagnosed on average 2.5 years later in Latine children than non-Latine white children in the United States. And one of the big reasons for this is the lack of understanding and lack of materials, resources, and education for non-English speaking Latines. So there's a lack of articles in Spanish, there's a lack of ability for English-speaking doctors to communicate to Spanish and Portuguese-speaking Latine parents. And even those doctors who are Spanish-speaking may not have up-to-date information on autism. So what one study showed was they looked in the California area at 267 primary care pediatricians. And this was done and published in 2013. And of those 267 primary care pediatricians, 30.4% offered general developmental disability screenings for children. 42.9% offered autism spectrum disorder screenings for children. But as for how many offered these screenings in Spanish, the numbers dropped significantly. 17.7% offered general developmental disability screenings in Spanish, and 28% offered autism screenings in Spanish. So this shows that doctors are less able to do diagnoses in Spanish, there's less doctors available. And one other thing which I'll touch on, autism for a lot of history has been seen as a white disorder, that the original studies done by Dr. Connor in the 1940s were done on white children, almost all of whom were in families that were in the upper middle class, socially visible. They were in who's who in America, and they were famous scientists. And so children of scientists and well-to-do white families kind of set the example of autism as we understood it for decades. And unfortunately, this is still pervasive, that there is a great lack of understanding of how autism manifests in non-white children, and that as an aspect of racism, often autism is missed because there is often this perception that a white child might have a disorder and might need supports, but a child of color who acts out can be seen as unruly, undisciplined, as a behavior trouble, and they're often diagnosed with other conditions that are somewhat have more stigma than autism.
So, one fact to be aware of when talking about the Latine autistic population is the systemic discrimination, lack of access to healthcare, and lack of access to employment opportunities that Latine people face. This may be related to immigration status or general racial bias and racial discrimination in society. For Latina women in particular, they make extremely less amounts of money, regardless of their educational status, immigration status, and job qualifications. They are making 67 cents for every dollar a white man would make for equivalent work. In addition to this, Latinas are amongst the least likely to have health insurance of different racial and ethnic minority groups in the United States. So again, this lack of health insurance leads to a lack of support needs being met for autistic folks and lack of diagnoses. Anecdotally, the other Latine autistic folks that I know almost all received their diagnoses late in life in their 20s and 30s. This includes my peer, Kayla Rodriguez at the Autistic Women Non-Binary Network, and other peers, including Eric Michael Garcia, from whom I'm drawing some of the research for this video. So one other problem with getting a diagnosis for your autistic child is that often people of color, including Latine folks, often do not get taken as seriously or are told to toughen up or that their symptoms aren't real, more so than white patients. And this is certainly true that some of the experiences in the studies that I've looked at said that parents felt that providers' dismissive behaviors and or lack of inquiry into parents' concerns delayed diagnosis. So again, this is not unique to Latine communities, but it is definitely a characteristic of marginalized communities where African-American Black communities are often overlooked for symptoms that in a white person would be more commonly diagnosed. And that is true also when we talk about Afro-Latines and Latine people who are Black and Brown. There are certain cultural factors within Latin American cultures in the U.S. and in Latin America which lead to a lack of understanding, a lack of willingness to understand and accept autism, and a hesitancy or resistance to seeking out diagnosis. So I want to approach this from a feminist and racial justice perspective, that certain aspects of Latin American culture that we assume are part of the culture are aspects of racism and colonization. And one of these cultural manifestations of racism and colonization that I want to talk about is Latino masculinity, often referred to with machismo. And for Latino men in the United States, machismo is very much tied to both the immigrant experience of needing to prove yourself, that you're manly, that you're tough, and cultural biases and assumptions about Latino men that they're supposed to be tough, aggressive gangsters, that they're spicy inherently, that the aggressiveness is in their blood, and that these are very racist concepts, and they're harmful concepts for masculinity that harm men and women, and they definitely harm autistic folks. Here I want to talk about fathers. As the study I cited in Academic Pediatrics explored, many of the people who sought diagnoses for their children were the mothers. That when the mothers approached their husbands, that often the husbands were dismissive or they didn't want to admit that their boy or child was somehow weak or disabled,
that in one case where a mother who had been seeking a diagnosis for her child went to her husband, he said, "Oh, nothing's wrong with the child. You're the one that's crazy." And this, they explored further in this study with Mexican-American men who talked about how they wanted that tough kid that they could take with them to the rodeo, that they could show to their coworkers, and that their shame that reflects poorly on a man, that they're somehow weak or not macho or masculine enough if they have a weak child who is autistic or disabled. So this shame about having a disabled child is not unique also to fathers. There are definitely accounts of mothers who kind of hide the fact that their child is disabled. One anecdote in this study talked about a family who would always close the door so their neighbors could never see that their child used a wheelchair. So another fact is that Latine autistic people are particularly harmed by race and gender stereotypes and bias against Latine people. So this goes hand in hand with Kimberly Crenshaw's theory of intersectionality, which was formulated around being a Black woman. But Latine women and femmes face particular discrimination in society that is unique to their identity. And I spoke with Kayla Rodriguez and helped edit a blog post that they just published on the Autistic Women and Nonbinary Network website. And in it, she talks about the spicy Latina trope, which is a very common Hollywood and even pre-Hollywood trope from opera of the spicy senoritas and hot tamales, this sexually aggressive, unstable, gonna steal your man, very gregarious, dance party type woman. Unfortunately for a lot of people, Hollywood and pop culture defines us. And for autistic people who may pick up on behavior and kind of mask by copying behaviors they might see on TV and media, kind of copying the, I like to usually point to Mimi from Rent. A lot of people talk about J-Lo, but these Carmen from the original opera, Carmen, these spicy Latinas, their sexual aggressivity and their flirtatiousness is not always the healthiest thing for a young person to copy and think of as normal. It leads to poor body image. Eating disorders are particularly prevalent in the autistic community and among women and femmes especially. And it leads to this idea that Latine women are sexually available. 77% of Latinas, according to a study, have been harassed in the workplace. And for Latine women and femmes in the autistic community who feel they could never live up to these stereotypes, and remember that it's really not based on reality, it's based on Hollywood and theater, there's often a feeling that you fail as a Latina, and I can very much relate to this, that I'm not the gregarious, dancey, you know, super hyper aggressive type Latina who's gonna steal your man. And also, I specifically say man because a lot of this trope is based around patriarchy and heteronormativity, and that Latina women are expected to particularly be desirable to men and desire men. So this presents a whole host of problems for the large number of LGBTQIA plus autistic folks, many of whom are Latine. So beyond just Latine women and femmes and the problems they face with media representation, I don't know of any mainstream media representation of autistic Latinx. I love to see media representation of autistic Latinx. And one more thing is, at the start of this, I kind of talked about Latin American machismo. For Latin American men, there's often this expectation of being hyper-masculine, and that young, introverted, shy, emotional, prone to shut down or meltdown young autistic boy is going to get bullied and mistreated for not living up to Latino machismo, patriarchal masculine stereotypes. So stereotypes kind of harm Latinas both ways and can be particularly difficult for autistics. And just one more thing is that we know that autistic folks are 6 to 7 times more likely to be transgender or gender non-binary. So these gender stereotypes really hurt a lot, I'd say all of the autistic community. One other fact to be aware of is that Latine autistic people are at a much higher risk of racial profiling, racialized violence, including police violence, incarceration, and violence in carceral systems, including institutions, than non-Latine, non-autistic people, and of course the combination with intersectionality, which we often refer to as racialized autism, that certain behaviors or characteristics of autism, like stimming or repetitive behaviors or communication differences, might be seen as threatening in a Black or brown autistic person that may not be seen as threatening in a white autistic person. Now, one of the most extreme and disturbing examples of this was the shooting of Charles Kinsey, and who was attending to a Latine autistic man, Arnoldo Rios Soto. So Charles Kinsey was a Black mental health provider, supporter for Arnoldo Rios Soto. And police responded to a call that there was a man who was threatening to neighbors. They thought he might have a gun or be threatening suicide. And in fact, it was the 27-year-old Latine man, Arnoldo Rios Soto, who was simply sitting outside of their group home. Not a big fan of group homes, by the way, but they were sitting outside their group home playing with a toy truck, and the police thought it might be a weapon. Specifically, they thought it was a gun. And so Charles Kinsey, a Black man, and a Latine man were on the sidewalk, Charles Kinsey with his hands up in the air, trying to calm down Rios Soto while trying to reassure officers that neither of them had a weapon, that they were not a threat. And police officers claimed they shot at Rios Soto when they wounded Charles Kinsey in the leg. Rios Soto panicked. He was detained. He was having an autistic meltdown, understandably, from someone being shot next to him. And they tranquilized him. And it was very brutal police mistreatment of a Black person helping an autistic Latine person. And this points to the fact that autism is often racialized as seen as a threat. I don't believe that if this man had been white, he would have been seen as much of a threat with a toy truck. Another example to talk about carceral systems and institutionalization is the Judge Rodenberg Center, which is infamous for using shock treatment, aversive therapy on the autistic people there. Now, I don't know the exact number of Latine people who may be housed there, but we do know that the majority of people housed there are Black and brown autistics. So this is why I feel, as an autistic movement, as a Latine movement, we really have to be working side by side with
Black Lives Matter and attempts to defund the police and end institutionalization and carceral systems of all forms in line with disability justice practice. So another fact is that Latinas are very underrepresented in the disability and autistic movements, particularly looking at organizations by and for disabled and autistic folks. There's a real lack of Latina leadership in executive director and director level roles. Also on boards of trustees and boards of directors, there's a real lack of representation. And this is something I'm particularly passionate about as a person who served on many nonprofit boards, as someone who has had leadership positions in the nonprofit sector, that I know what it is like to feel isolated and tokenized as a transgender, disabled, Latina, queer person. So I very much feel like there is a leadership gap. There's a great report, which I highly recommend, screenshot there, of the discrimination and the impact of racial bias on career advancement in the nonprofit sector. So we often in the nonprofit sector think that we're better than being racist, but that's patently false. A lot of nonprofits founded by white executive directors and who've traditionally and historically had majority white boards of directors have real problems with not only attracting people of color into leadership roles, but supporting those Black, Indigenous, people of color, including Latina folks. And for Latinas, that may translate into not attention to our specific needs, which I've outlined in this video about healthcare access, language access, understanding specifics of Latina culture and how that impacts our autisticness. And the feeling of tokenization, as I mentioned, is really only one you can solve by putting the majority of the leadership of your organization being BIPOC, putting people in leadership roles. The more people of color on your boards and in leadership roles, the more people of color are going to be attracted to work for your organization and feel supported there. And again, link below, the Race to Lead report has great data on how to support people of color to move up in leadership roles. They have specific breakdowns for Latinas, for Latina women, for trans folks, and how race impacts their leadership in the nonprofit sector. So philanthropists, funders, should really be looking to fund organizations that are led by BIPOC folks. And I do think there should be pressure put on organizations that are historically white, that still have a lot of white people kind of driving their policy agendas, to demand that they serve the community. So, if you're one of the people who feels marginalized, tokenized, or left out of the autistic and neurodiversity and disability movements, I encourage you to keep raising your voice, because it's important that we see ourselves represented. Bia is with me here in Huehuetenango, Guatemala, and we're gonna wish you goodbye for this video, and I hope to catch you in future videos. Please do take a moment to subscribe. I release videos every Friday. Hit that notification bell to get notified of future videos. And please, if you're helped by this video or have some of your own tips or thoughts, leave a comment. Thank you to everyone who supports me, everyone who gives a like on this video, and my patrons. You can support me financially on Patreon at patreon.com/KayleeWhalen. And until next time, see ya. Thank you.